Okay, everyone ready? Radio silent.
I was speaking into my stopwatch.
I'm recording it.
All right, everyone ready? Radio silence, please. Cameras ready.
Well, for starters, it's a bit slow. I mean, if I ran, it would be faster.
Oh, I've got him on the launch.
Ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba. Hello, welcome to episode 8 of the Cars.co.za show. I'm Ciro de Siena, and you join me in my home as we record under level 3 of South Africa's COVID-19 response. This is actually going to be the final episode in season 1 of the Cars.co.za show, our first ever long format show. And I'm getting a bit emotional. It's been quite a ride. But I'm very excited to be here with you. Thanks for hanging out with me. We've got a bumper episode coming up for you. Not 5, but 6 films. Coming up first, we take a look at a serious condition affecting the local car market. I then take not one, but 2 Lamborghinis up a mountain pass. We head to Zambia and Botswana to drive the Land Rover Discovery and Range Rover Evoque. We take a look at an exceptional drift car built right here in Cape Town. We go back to January of this year for the Cars.co.za Consumer Awards after movie. And lastly, we take a look at the restoration of our very own Alfa Romeo GTV6. But up first, I thought that I needed to highlight what is a growing trend that's been affecting South Africans for a good couple of years now. It's something that bothers myself and my colleagues immensely. It's called anti-stationwagonism. Situated in the Western Cape of South Africa, Cape Town is the second largest car market in the country. And it is into this market in 2018 that Subaru will launch a new model. It's called the Levorg, and it is a station wagon. This is being seen as a bold move in a country where most car buyers suffer from a condition called anti-station wagonism. So what is this condition and where does it come from?
Anti-station wagonism is very widespread in South Africa. Every month, nearly 30,000 passenger vehicles are sold across the country. Approximately 50 of those are station wagons. The situation is so severe that companies such as BMW don't even sell station wagons locally anymore, and Mercedes-Benz will only bring them in on special order.
This generation of the Levorg is just a preview of the facelifted version, which will arrive in South Africa next year. But not only does the Levorg have to overcome the trends of the market, it also has to overcome some personal issues, the most notable of which is the name. And that's because Levorg, spelled backwards, says grovel. But the car does feature Subaru's signature bonnet scoop, which has been scientifically proven to excite car enthusiasts.
Experts have long maintained that the effects of anti-station wagonism on people who actually like station wagons is misunderstood and often goes underreported. This is Ashley Oldfield. He's a car journalist and average mountain biker. He also owns a dog. I asked him where he thought the condition originated.
I think it came in when the introduction of the SUV arrived in South Africa, and this stigma that bigger in South Africa is better, like a bigger rugby player is a better rugby player. So the bigger car is essentially a better car, and I think the South African mentality supports that. The station wagon's a great car. It offers you car-like driving dynamics, which are better than SUV dynamics, and you get all the boot space you can ever get from an SUV as well. Station wagon is is diminishing on our roads as we speak. It's being overcome by the disease that is SUV fever.
But of course, the reality is that these days, most car buyers opt for SUVs. In recent years, we've seen an explosion in terms of units sold and models on offer. And most anti-station wagonists believe that station wagons are just not as practical as SUVs. But that's not the case with the Levorg. In fact, the boot area is larger than that of the Subaru Forester and the Mazda CX-5. And the Levorg will tow up to 1.2 tons with a braked trailer. That's more than a diesel Toyota RAV4.
And because there are so few station wagons on sale in South Africa, cars like the Toyota RAV4 are the Subaru's real rivals in our market. But it is likely to be a bit more expensive and hit the market at approximately 550,000 rand. But the Subaru is unique in that it offers a sporty interior and sports car power and handling with a powerful 2-litre turbo boxer motor and symmetrical all-wheel drive. It's a driver's car as well as being very practical, something SUVs just can't match. All things considered, the Levorg is a powerful antidote to anti-station wagonism. We wanted to understand what it was like to actually own a station wagon in South Africa. We set out to find a local motorist who was willing to share his experience with us. This is Bradley Abrams. He currently owns this rare Mercedes E-Class station wagon and has owned Volvo station wagons in the past. He says that anti-station wagonism affects him on a daily basis.
At times it's lonely, but you know, it's an amazing feeling knowing that you are just mentally superior to most people out there. You know, station wagons are pretty much the ultimate car. I mean, it's just science, actually. It's fact.
And how do you feel the market has been affected by anti-station wagonism?
It has completely crushed my chances of ever owning an E63 wagon. For that matter, C63. Pretty much any decent sports wagon out there ever.
Mr. Abrams says receiving random nods and smiles from other station wagon owners when he's out on the roads gives him hope and reminds him he's not alone.
It's still unclear as to why South African car buyers have fallen off the wagon. But experts in the industry and fans of station wagons believe that the Subaru Levorg has what it takes to turn the tide against anti-station wagonism. However, the local market is being flooded with affordable and appealing SUVs. And so companies like Subaru will have to price the Levorg attractively to convince South African motorists that station wagons can be elegant and practical solutions to their motoring needs. Certainly, it would be a sad state of affairs if the station wagon were to disappear from our roads. Ciro de Siena, Cars.co.za, Cape Town. Now, if you or someone you know is suffering from anti-station wagonism, please reach out to the Cars.co.za team on social media or email, and we'll see what we can do. We'll try and help. Right, in our next film, Lamborghini gave us a call and said, listen, we've just launched two new versions of our Huracan, I never know how to pronounce that, supercar, and would you like to drive them? It's the Spyder and the rear-wheel drive version. And we said, yes, that sounds lovely. Could we possibly drive them on one day? And they said, absolutely. The insurance for the shoot was a freaking nightmare. But anyway, it goes back a couple of years on our YouTube channel to a time where I had more hair. Welcome to the Lamborghini Huracan LP610-4 Spyder.
like the hardtop version we drove last year, except, you know, you can take the roof off. To make space for the roof in the back here, they've had to encroach on the passenger space. And, well, I'm only 5'9", and I don't feel like there's enough space in here for me. This being a Spyder, obviously the roof goes up and down. To operate it, you have to turn the engine on. And then you simply hold down one button. There's no levers or manual clasps or anything like that. It's fully electric. It's so impressive how the whole roof sits on top of the V10 engine in this little cavity over here. And the entire operation takes just 17 seconds. And even though it's a convertible, they've still managed to keep the height of the car under 1.2 meters. It's actually incredible how much driving modes and the ability to change a car's characteristics has affected the world of supercars. The Huracan has three modes: Strada, which is the most boring and docile. Then there's Corsa, which is for racing, and we don't want that today. And then there's Sport, which is just right. Flick it into Sport using the switch on the bottom of the steering wheel, and the exhaust is louder, the throttle is sharper. The car will blip the throttle on downshift and drop a bit of petrol into the exhaust. Snap, crackle and pop out the back. It's almost easy to forget that this is a Lamborghini when you have it in Strada mode, but in Sport, you're reminded you're driving a 600 horsepower lightweight Italian sports car. Oh. I am having the best morning. So the Huracan has its problems, but it still has the 5.2 liter V10. It still has 610 horsepower. Still will do 0 to 100 in 3.4 seconds. And that's 0.2 seconds slower than its hardtop sibling. Who cares? Sometimes it's just nice to be reminded what it's like to just drive. Oh.
Driving a Huracan Spyder was always going to be emotional, but could it be stripped down? Lamborghini asked themselves the same question, and this is the result.
They were on special. Right, the LP580-2. If you've been paying attention, you'll realize that the 580 means it has 30 less horsepower than the LP610, and the dash 2 means it's rear wheel drive. So for this edition, Lamborghini seems to have gone back to basics. There's no carbon ceramic brakes. The car is quite a bit cheaper. It's quite a bit lighter as well. For some reason, they've dialed down the power on the 5.2 liter V10. So is this the Huracan to bring back Lamborghini's Mad Hatter reputation? Well, let's put it in Sport and find out. Hello. Certainly not twitchy at the rear, that's for sure. It's really planted really sure-footed actually. The nose maybe feels a little bit lighter than in the four-wheel drive model. But the steering is a joy. It's so much more direct. Oh, I love it in here. And while the convertible, you get that noise coming in through the open roof, in the hardtop, it just feels like you're much more part of the experience. The engine is right behind me here. All that's separating me and those 10 fiery cylinders is one little glass wall. Where the convertible feels more like it could just go on a Sunday cruise, this feels like it would be happier at a Sunday track day. If I could have this steering in that 610, I think that would pretty much be the perfect car. I don't know if I can drive fast enough personally or on this road to get near the limits of traction in this car, so you're not going to see me going sideways around a corner smoking my tires. But what I can tell you is that at slightly insane speeds, there's tons of grip here. In fact, when this car lets go, you better know what you're doing, because you're going to be going very quickly at that point. If you enjoy going sideways and smoking your tires and living your life on the limits of grip, then yes, you will probably enjoy the 580-2. And while that convertible annoys me, it's got some annoying habits. It's just one of those cars where, when all the factors come together, when the weather's perfect, the top's down, the road is open, you can use that 5.2 liter V10 to the best of its abilities, then that's probably one of the best motoring experiences right now available. And while I like this car, I love that convertible. Ah, I'm almost annoyed with myself. I want to like this one. I don't want to like the convertible.
Now this next film goes all the way back to 2015. This was in the very early days of the Cars.co.za YouTube channel. We've managed to build up that channel to 205,000 subscribers. In fact, in terms of subscribers, it is the largest branded YouTube channel in South Africa. And wow, it's been quite a journey, especially for me personally. It's really changed my life working for this company and building this YouTube channel. And talking about journeys, one of the best experiences you can have in a car is overlanding across Africa. So when Land Rover gave us a call and said, would you like to come drive through Botswana and Zambia with us, I absolutely jumped at the opportunity. And the two cars that we were going to drive was the newly launched Land Rover Discovery and the Range Rover Evoque, which struck me as a really, really odd choice to drive through Africa with. I was like, are you guys sure about this?
Most of our car journeys these days are short, frustrating, traffic-filled darts across town. And most of our cars do that quite well. But just north of our border, there is the opportunity to experience the exact opposite. It's called overlanding. But you need a certain kind of vehicle. We were invited to crisscross Zambia and Botswana in the latest Range Rover Evoque and Land Rover Discovery, dodging elephants, drinking coffee, and getting lost. Paddle!
You went the wrong way.
In Zambia, the facelifted Evoque was up first as a sort of appetizer. And given that it was the rainiest rainy season in 30 years, this felt like anything but its natural habitat. I was seriously impressed and surprised by the Evoque's capabilities. For a 4x4 using only electronic off-road systems and no low range, it didn't falter once as we splashed across Zambia.
So, the baby Range Rover, good for popping down to the shops, looking good on the school run, and maybe heading over to the garden center to pick up some designer pot plants. So it's really nice to know that if you needed to, it'll take you to what feels like the ends of the earth.
It was time to find the discoveries, but first we had to negotiate the rather wide Zambezi.
Obviously, we're in the middle of nowhere, so there aren't any bridges. So we're going to try and cross the Zambezi on a ferry, which looks like it was put together by a couple of seven-year-olds with some Meccano sets, which is a little bit nerve-wracking.
This is exactly like popping down to the shops. Almost virtually the same, really, as driving into a mall parking lot.
There we go. I'm now on a ferry on the Zambezi in a Range Rover Evoque. If I'm honest, when I started this job, I didn't think I'd ever do something like this. This is a lot of fun.
Then we ditched the Evoques and boarded a plane to nowhere.
I am in a Land Rover. It's called the Discovery and it's built for discovering things, which I'm currently doing in Zambia. No, Botswana. Zambia was yesterday. We took a ferry to get between the two.
What the hell is that noise? Oh, it's an aeroplane.
I'm trying to make a video. Rude pilot.
So there's no doubt that this new Land Rover Discovery 4 is very capable. It must be the most capable Discovery ever, but the same clever systems which make it capable also make it very vulnerable. I just get the feeling that you could fix an old Land Rover Defender with a Leatherman and a spanner. And if you needed to fix one of these, you'd need a laptop and a satellite phone. Look at me driving through some mud. Terribly difficult. Mud, more mud, sand, mud. Ah. Shush, I know it's grass, stop beeping at me. I have a solution to all of this car's electronic problems, so if anyone at Land Rover is listening, here it is. It's called Africa Mode. Just one button in the shape of Africa on the dash, and you hit that, and it switches off all the electronics and returns it to something like a Defender. Oh, this is brilliant. It's hard to put into words how confident this car makes you feel when tackling the rough stuff. Take that, Africa. Bask in the magnificence of my luxurious capability. Nearly missed the road there. I'm driving the new SDV6, and I must be honest, I don't know why you'd buy a petrol Land Rover. The fuel savings are massive, and it's so quiet, and it works so well with the gearbox. It's just such a seamless, comfortable drive. Diesel really has come a long way. The new Discovery is a little bit expensive. It's about 900,000 Rand by the time you fit it with things that you like. And that means that it's about the same price as a nice house. But I think this car makes a very good argument for buying one instead of a house, and I'll tell you why. The front seats are extremely comfortable. In fact, this is actually much nicer than my lounge at home. The rear folds completely flat, and you can get a double bed in there. I've tested that at a music festival. And it's got a flat screen TV. Which house comes with that? You'd have to buy that extra if you bought a house. And aircon. You'd have to buy aircon extra. So just buy a Discovery. The Land Rover Discovery is the sort of car that can take you to the sort of place where you have to be escorted to your tent because there are hippos and hyenas around. Last night I had to look on a map to see where we are. I still don't know. At least there's coffee though.
That was, without a doubt, one of the coolest trips I have ever been on. It was my first overlanding trip through Africa, and I didn't know what to expect, but it was just so memorable. Seeing the Vic Falls after a wet, rainy season like that was one of the most powerful things I've ever seen. If you ever get a chance to get there, you absolutely have to go. And of course, driving just makes it that much more enjoyable. Right, in our next film, you know, over the years where we've been making these videos, we've met some incredibly passionate people who build cars from nothing. They take cars apart, put them back together, and usually make them a lot faster than they used to be. So in this next film, we meet Matt from the Smokum Garage here in Cape Town. And this is one of his favorite projects. This is a real personal dream of his to build this car. And not only does he present the car to us and tell us its story, but we tag along as a UK drifter flies down to Cape Town to take the car out and compete in the annual Drift City competition right here in Cape Town.
We all started loving cars at an early age and then kind of took it a next step further by starting a workshop and kind of trying to bring things we saw and imagined to life, essentially. Basically, we do everything to do with cars, from building race cars to show cars. Yeah, we're kind of finding our way in an industry that's quite a difficult one in South Africa. I got the car about a year and a half ago. It's a Nissan S14, which is basically the Nissan S chassis. I think it's a brilliant car, and you know, it's something that you see in all the magazines and things like that overseas and on the internet, and it was just something I kind of fell in love with. So I managed to find one, a really decent quality one.
It by no means looks like what it looked like when we got it started. We basically did a full build. We put a full roll cage in. We got rid of pretty much everything that doesn't need to be there, but still keeping it comfortable.
We've made our own custom straight pipe exhaust. We got about 230 kilowatts at the wheels and about 385 newton meters of torque.
It's a really cool chassis to work on, but availability of all your aesthetical things are very difficult. And I was looking online and I found a really cool RC car of this S14 boss that I just thought this guy had got it right with color combo and all of that. So I said, let's make this car in real life. We've got everything sitting there now, all the bits and pieces, we just got to put it together. Well, I met Dan at Gymkhana Grid last year. We were up there with Jason and the Mustang, and they were actually pitting next to us, and there's always a time at a race where someone needs some help, whether we needed a certain tool that we maybe didn't have with us, or they needed something, and we kind of just connected, and then from there we were hanging out in the evenings, and since then we've become friends. And Dan said he wanted to come down to Cape Town for a little bit of a holiday, so I suggested, hey, well, we've got Drift City, I've got an S14 sitting here, let's plan it around that. Drift City, it's been going for 3 years, at the Grand Parade on the 24th of September, which is Heritage Day. I mean, just those two factors alone, with the mountain as a backdrop, that alone ticks all the boxes for me.
Hi, my name's Danny, I'm from London, UK. I'm here now to compete in Drift City. I've been competing in Gymkhana Grid for 5 years now. So I started about 8 years ago. Friends of ours invited me down to a drift day, and they gave us some lessons and kind of got the bug from there, and then bought my first drift car about 6 years ago, and then just started messing about and then building up from there, really. Competing in little competitions, local stuff, Formula G, doing some drift days, and that's what's got me into where I am now. The highlights is getting the podiums. That's what we all want. We're all aiming for the top spot, you know, but being there on one of the three is everything that you aim for. Obviously, we want the highest one possible, but that isn't always possible. The smell of fuel, the smell of rubber, that adrenaline when you sat at the start line, you look across at your opponent, you're watching the lights drop, and then you just go. Yeah, I love it.
So, we got here this morning, perfect, happy days. Set everything up, went out and done the first burnout for the first run. Car died, pushed it back in, and we got terminal problems. The bottom end went, and the piston rings are gone.
Letdowns are cars, mainly. Or not qualifying, that's the lowest level, not actually qualifying for an event, so.
The car was awesome in practice prior to the event, and it's kind of a mixed bag of emotions. You got this hype up of the event and everything going on, and then this split second everything gets pulled from under your feet. Feels like the end of the world, but after a few moments of gathering yourself, you kind of figure out what's the next best plan. And that's the one thing about South Africa that I've found with motorsport is awesome, is the kind of support from other teams. Within 5 minutes, I had people walk up to us, hear the keys to our workshop, go grab this car.
We've kindly been donated this from Otto, which is a Toyota Sora. It's got a 302 from a Ford, and it's really hard work, to say the least. It's on stock suspension, it's set up for high-speed drift. But we've managed to get two practice runs in. I've just gone and done my two qualifying runs, so we'll wait to see what's going on.
Ladies and gentlemen, you might not know him, Let me introduce Danny Cross. He is an international drift athlete as well as an international Japan athlete. Craven Motorsport just came to the rescue. They have literally borrowed Arthur Craven's rocket car, which is in practice car. He is a Toyota Sora with a V8, just so that Danny can compete.
So yeah, I suppose the positive things that ended up kind of coming from this were the fact that we still got to compete. It's something you learn from, and you can only improve so that you can avoid situations like that in the future. The things that have now come from that are in the pipeline, there's possible future builds and collaborations and all sorts of things that, you know, wasn't even thought of before the day of the event and all the kind of chaos erupting.
Coming up next, let's go back to January of this year, a simpler time where there was no such thing really as the coronavirus. Oh, how I long for such a time. And we got to celebrate the 5th ever Cars.co.za Consumer Awards powered by Wesbank. It was the biggest ceremony that we've ever staged in Consumer Awards history. Now, if you're not familiar with our awards, after a 4-month rigorous judging process, we hand out 12 awards to the best cars in 12 categories in South Africa. The aim is to help South African consumers make better purchasing decisions. We also hand out the Brand of the Year Award, which is completely voted for by you, the consumer, through our consumer satisfaction survey. But this year, the event was pretty special for a number of reasons. But stick around, because after this video, I'm very excited to share with you the story of the restoration of the rarest car in our South African heritage fleet.
Welcome, my name is Bonang Mateba. A very warm welcome to each and every one of you to Cars.co.za, the Consumer Awards, proudly powered by Wesbank. It's going to be an incredible event here this evening.
This year, Cars.co.za staged the 5th annual Cars.co.za Consumer Awards, and I don't think there was a better way to start the show than Casper in Your Vest singing his hit track as our incredible MC for the night arrived on stage in our very own Gushesh.
Isn't she beautiful, ladies and gentlemen?
Thank you. We had to get that restored Gushesha from our sentimental collection. Isn't that a beauty?
To kick off the night, the CEO of Wesbank delivered a keynote address.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give him a warm round of applause from Wesbank, Mr. Christa Koch.
And then some of South Africa's favorite faces joined us to hand out the awards.
Please put your hands together for Lala Hirayama, Ms. Cosmo, Mr. Ghana Mcivi, Ciro de Siena. Give him a round of applause. Nico Finaggio. Please put your hands together for Wendy Nola. Maps Mabonyane.
With over 450 guests in attendance, it was time to finally hand out the trophies. The judging process always starts in September of the year before and includes 2 days of intensive testing at Girotech with 20 judges and 39 cars on site.
Let's do it.
There are 13 category wins up for grabs, and at the very end of the evening, the coveted brand of the year announcement would be made. Halfway through the proceedings, we took a break from the awards and the head of our sentimental brand, Hannes Oosthuizen, arrived on stage to introduce a few cars that are very close to our hearts. At last year's ceremony, we revealed our completely restored Opel Superbus to the crowd, but this year we had added 4 cars to our sentimental fleet. A BMW 325 IS Evo 1, a BMW 325 IS Evo 2, a Ford Capri Piranha, and fresh from its 12-month restoration, we were delighted to reveal the rarest car in our collection.
I introduce you to our Alfa Romeo GTV6 3-litre.
Back to the awards, and it continued to be a very good night for Volkswagen.
Another one for VW. Give them a round of applause.
It is a very good night for Volkswagen. Congratulations, the Arteon is the winner.
Let's hear it for BMW. Congratulations.
Yeah, well done,
and there they are, Nico. You do the honors. Take a look at who powered themselves to the final. No. Oh my gosh, no! Again and again! Volkswagen, congratulations, a 6th time.
All right, you're ready to take a look at the scores.
Oh man!
There we
go! The Suzuki Swift 1.2 GLX is our budget car of the year winner. So I think she's the perfect person to come help me with the next award. Ladies and gents, one more time, Miss Cosmo!
You can feel the pulse, you can feel the vibe.
It's a really authentic way to compare the finalists, I think.
And it's really been an absolute evolution, really bringing the consumer awards to the consumers.
With Wesbank Motors CEO Ghanem Sibi on stage and Cars.co.za co-founder Alistair McMurray arriving to help hand out the final award of the night, Cars.co.za co-founder Ross McElroy exited the stage stylishly.
I'll leave you guys to hand out the very coveted Brand of the Year award.
I love that. All right.
With literally the largest trophy of the night handed out, the after party kicked off with Miss Cosmo on the decks. A huge thank you to our partner Wesbank, whose contribution to our awards project has been invaluable over the years. For more information on all the finalists and the winners of this year's Consumer Awards, head to carsawards.co.za.
The 80s and 90s in South Africa produced some of the rarest and most incredible cars in our country's history. Cars that were built and only ever sold in South Africa. And as you saw in our awards film, we own five of them in our heritage fleet. The idea is to keep and preserve South Africa's incredible and unique motoring history. And as you saw in that video, we revealed for the first time our Alfa Romeo GTV6 3-liter. Now those letters and numbers stir a lot of passion, especially amongst the Alfisti in South Africa and around the world. This is the rarest car in our collection, and its story of how we found it and how we restored it is really worth sharing.
This is a car which was built and only ever sold in South Africa. It was the result of a rare collaboration between a local importer and the brand's mothership in Italy. Only 212 of these were built, and over the last 36 years, they have been written off, modified to ruin, or their rebuilds abandoned. There are only about 40 left. These are extremely difficult cars to restore. Spare parts are virtually non-existent. So of course, we had to have one, but it had to be the right one from the right kind of owner.
I saw my first liter when I was in the army in Bloemfontein, 1984. And from there on, I thought, no, that's what I want.
This is Bussy Turan. He spent his entire life restoring cars, but this one meant a lot to him, mostly because it was his. He spent over 10 years collecting parts for the car and agreed to sell it to us if we helped him finish the project.
So when I built one and it stays in Africa, I'll build it. If you want to take it overseas, I'm not going to build it. And that's the way I'm doing it. I want to keep them in SA.
That's pretty much exactly what we had in mind. Over the next 12 months, the restoration team worked non-stop on bringing the car back to life.
There's no one else can be who will get the car together like these two guys.
You love them or you don't love them. Well, that's how it is. That was just one of a kind. It was homemade. And it showed the world that we can.
There we go. That's it. That's everything for episode 8, the season finale of season 1 of the Cars.co.za show. Thank you so much for joining me on this journey. This has been a dream of mine pretty much my entire adult life, to get a long format show together, to get it onto TV, which we've done with the help of the team at Ignition, DSTV channel 189. Big shout out to them. Thank you for helping us with this. It's been an extraordinary time. History is really being made. As I'm recording this, it's level 3 of the lockdown in South Africa's COVID response. I think there are some really tough times ahead. And when we created this show, we wanted to make something to entertain you, to distract you, to hopefully make you smile during this really difficult time in our nation's history. And I hope we've done that. We've received some incredible feedback on the show. Thank you for reaching out to us. It's been a lot of fun. It's been really difficult. I've had to do this mostly on my own. I haven't seen any of my team in 75 days. I'm really looking forward to seeing them all again and working, you know, in the same room. That would be nice, instead of over Zoom calls all the time. But thank you very much for watching. Look after yourselves from everyone at Cars.co.za. Stay safe and look after each other. I very much look forward to making season 2 of the Cars.co.za show. But remember, our YouTube channel will carry on. We'll be uploading videos every single week. And of course, the Cars.co.za website is fully up and running. Thank you very much for watching. Thank you for spending time with me. I'll see you soon. Bye for now.